A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus proceeded on his journey up to Jerusalem. As he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. He said, "Go into the village opposite you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone should ask, 'Why are you untying it?' you will answer, 'The master has need of it.' So those who had been sent went off and found everything just as Jesus had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners said to them, 'Why are you untying this colt?' They answered, 'The master has need of it.' So they brought him to Jesus, threw their cloaks over the colt, and helped Jesus to mount. As he rode along, the people were spreading their cloaks on the road. And now, as he was approaching the slope of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to praise God aloud with joy for all the mighty deeds they had seen. They proclaimed, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' Jesus said in reply, 'I tell you, if they keep silent, the stones will cry out.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Good afternoon, and God bless you for being here today to celebrate the Palm Sunday of the Passion of the Lord. We extend a warm welcome for all of those who are visiting us today. The Lord is our help, who never abandons us. Assured of this steadfast love, we bring our needs and the needs of the whole world. Our Mass intentions are for Ezekiel Guadalupe and Ezekiel Jr. Godinez, Carlos Godinez, Virginia Moore, Marlene and Martina Reyes, Alvina Rodriguez, Rudy Quintanilla, Juanita and Max Sanchez, and for the 49th wedding anniversary of Ray and Sally Anguiano.
Thank you.
who have revealed in the humility of your Son the call to oneness for the human community in your saving love. Make Christ crucified and risen from the dead bring us peace of mind and heart, and lead us to new life every week of our lives. For he lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheek to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore, I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial song. My God, why have you abandoned me?
My God, why have you abandoned me?
All who see me scoff at me. They mock me with parted lips. They wag their heads. He relied on the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he loves him.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
Many dogs surround me. A pack of evildoers closes in upon me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
They divide my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. But you, O Lord, be not far from me. O my help, hasten to aid me.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
I will proclaim your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, give glory to him. Revere him. All you descendants of Israel.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name.
Praise and honor to you, Lord.
Christ according to Luke. When the hour came, Jesus took his place at table with the apostles. He said to them,
I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I shall not eat it again until there is fulfillment in the kingdom of God.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and said,
Take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you that from this time on I shall not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.
Then he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying,
This is my body, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me.
And likewise the cup, after they had eaten, saying,
This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which will be shed for you. And yet behold, the hand of the one who is to betray me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man indeed goes, as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed.
And they began to debate among themselves who among them would do such a deed. Then an argument broke out among them about which of them should be regarded as the greatest. He said to them,
The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are addressed as benefactors. But among you it shall not be so. Rather, let the greatest among you be as the youngest, and the leader as the servant. For who is greater, the one seated at table, or the one who serves? Is it not the one seated at table? I am among you as the one who serves. It is you who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer a kingdom on you, just as my Father has conferred one on me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. And you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat. But I have prayed that your own faith may not fail. And once you have turned back, you must strengthen your brothers.
He said to him,
Lord, I am prepared to go to prison and to die with you.
But he replied,
I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows this day, you will deny three times that you know me.
He said to them,
When I sent you forth without a money bag or a sack or sandals, were you in need of anything?
No.
They replied, He said to them,
But now one who has a money bag should take it, and likewise a sack. And one who does not have a sword should sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you, that this scripture must be fulfilled in me, namely, he was counted among the wicked. And indeed, what is written about me is coming to fulfillment.
Then they said,
Lord, look, there are two swords here.
Then he replied,
It is enough.
Then, going out, he went as was his custom to the Mount of Olives. And the disciples followed him. When he arrived at that place, he said to them,
Pray that you may not undergo the test.
After withdrawing about a stone's throw from them and kneeling, he prayed, saying,
Father, if you are willing, take this cup away from me. Still not my will, but yours be done.
And to strengthen him, an angel from heaven appeared to him. He was in such agony, and he prayed so fervently that his sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he rose from prayer and returned to his disciples, He found them sleeping from grief. He said to them,
"Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not undergo the test."
While he was still speaking, a crowd approached, and in front was one of the 12, a man named Judas. He went up to Jesus to kiss him. Jesus said to him,
"Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?"
His disciples realized what was about to happen, and they asked,
"Lord, shall we strike with the sword?"
And one of them struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said in reply,
"Stop, no more of this."
Then he touched the servant's ear and healed him. And Jesus said to the chief priests and temple guards and elders who had come for him,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs? Day after day I was with you in the temple area, and you did not seize me. But this is your hour, the time for the power of darkness."
After arresting him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter was following at a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat around it, and Peter sat down with them. When a maid saw him seated in the light, she looked intently at him and said,
"This man is who was with him."
But he denied it, saying,
"Woman, I do not know him."
A short while later, someone else saw him and said,
"You too are one of them."
But Peter answered,
"My friend, I am not."
About an hour later, still another insisted,
"Assuredly, it's this man too who was with him, for he also was a Galilean."
But Peter said,
"My friend, I do not know what you are talking about."
Just as he was saying this, the cock crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me 3 times. He went out and began to weep bitterly. The men who held Jesus in custody were ridiculing him and beating him. They blindfolded him and questioned him, saying,
"Prophecy, who is that struggling?"
And they reviled him, saying many other things against him. When the day came, the council of elders of the people met, both chief priests and scribes, and they brought him before their Sanhedrin. They said,
"If you are the Christ, tell us."
Then he replied to them,
"If I tell you, you will not believe, and if I question, you will not respond. But from this time on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God."
They all asked,
"Are you then the Son of God?"
He replied to them,
"You say that I am."
Then they said,
"What further need have we for testimony? We have heard it from his own mouth."
Then the whole assembly of them arose and brought him before Pilate. They brought charges against him, saying,
"We found this man deceiving our people. He opposes the payment of taxes to Caesar and maintains that he is Christ the King."
Pilate asked him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
He said to him and replied,
"You say so."
Pilate then addressed the chief priests and the crowds,
"I find this man not guilty."
But they were adamant and said,
"He is excited to the people who speak from Galilee."
On hearing this, Pilate asked the man if the man was a Galilean. And upon learning that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was in Jerusalem at that time. Herod was very glad to see Jesus. He had been wanting to see him for a long time, for he had heard about him and had been hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at length, but he gave no answer. The chief priests and scribes, meanwhile, stood by, accusing him harshly. Herod and his soldiers treated him contemptuously, and he mocked them. And after clothing him in resplendent garb, he sent him back to Pilate. Herod and Pilate became friends that very day, even though they had been enemies formerly. Pilate then summoned the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them,
"You brought this man to me and accused him of inciting the people to revolt. I have conducted my investigation in your presence and have not found this man guilty of the charges you have brought against him, nor did Herod, for he sent him back to us. So no capital crime has been committed by him. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
But all together they shouted out,
"Away with this man! He leaves Barabbas to us!"
Now, Barabbas had been imprisoned for a rebellion that had taken place in the city, and for murder. Again, Pilate addressed them, still wishing to release Jesus, but they continued their shouting,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate addressed them a third time,
"What evil has this man done? I found him guilty of no capital crime. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
With loud shouts, however, they persisted in calling for his crucifixion, and their voices prevailed. The verdict of Pilate was that their demand should be granted. So he released the man who had been imprisoned for rebellion and murder, for whom they asked, and he handed Jesus over to them to deal with as they wished. As they led him away, they took hold of a certain Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country. And after laying the cross on him, they made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus turned to them and said,
"Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children. For indeed, the days are coming when people will say, 'Blessed are the barren, wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' At that time, people will say to the mountains, 'Fall upon us,' to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if these things are done when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
Now, two others, both criminals, were led away with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him and the criminals there, one on his right, the other on his left. Then Jesus said,
"Father, forgive them. They know not what they do."
They divided his garments by casting lots. The people stood by and watched. The rulers, meanwhile, sneered at him and said,
"He saved others, and let him save himself, if he is the chosen one, the Christ of God."
Even the soldiers jeered at him. As they approached to offer him wine, they called out,
"If you are the King of the Jews, you save yourself."
Above him, there was an inscription that read, "This is the King of the Jews." Now, one of the criminals hanging there reviled Jesus, saying,
"Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us."
The other, however, rebuking him, said in reply,
"Have you no fear of God? For you are the subject to the same condemnation. And indeed, we have been condemned justly, for the sentence we receive corresponds to our crimes. But this man has done nothing criminal."
Then he said,
"Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
He replied to him,
"Amen, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise."
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Father, into your hands I commend my spirit."
And when he said this, he breathed his last. The centurion who witnessed what had happened glorified God and said,
"This man was innocent beyond doubt."
When all the people who had gathered for this spectacle saw what had happened, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances stood at a distance, including the women who had followed him from Galilee and saw these events. Now there was a virtuous and righteous man named Joseph, who, though he was a member of the council, had not consented to their plan of action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea and was awaiting the kingdom of God. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. After he had taken the body down, he wrapped it in a linen cloth and laid him in a rock-hewn tomb in which no one had yet been buried. It was a day of preparation, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come from Galilee with him followed behind. And when they had seen the tomb and the way in which his body was laid in it, they returned and prepared spices and perfumed oils. Then they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. The movie E.T. was popular. Maybe we've seen it a few times. E.T. standing for extraterrestrial, which means some type of an alien from another planet or another galaxy in the universe. The character who was the extraterrestrial in the movie, kind of ugly, but it was done nice. People liked the movie. Maybe we've seen it a few times. Maybe we've had conversations with people about ETs, extraterrestrials. We wonder sometimes, I wonder if somebody's landed from another planet. Some alien walking around here on Earth, some foreign creation. And that debate can go on and on, because there are many who contend there's life on other planets or life in other solar systems or universes or other galaxies. Debate on. However, when it comes to Jesus, he is not an extraterrestrial. He is not some type of an alien from another planet, another galaxy. Some people like to call it heaven. That is, come upon this earth, and then in the rather confusing language of that poetry from St. Paul to the Philippians today, articulating Jesus as having the appearance of a human. Not good enough, Paul. Because the incarnation, Christmas, the birth of Jesus, of Mary, emphasizes that not only is Jesus human in appearance, he is human, fully human. And there's the great paradox of the Holy Week that we are remembering starting today. Paradox of how Jesus is fully human because he has the fullness of the divine within him. He's the Son of God. But it's because of his divine oneness with his Father's will that he is fully human. Specifically, he embraces suffering, dying, and death. Yep. Doesn't stop there, though. He also embraces the empty tomb, risen life. And there it is. The fullness of our humanity is clarified in Christ, the risen Savior. This is a holy week, and we spend a lot of energy and liturgy and time together remembering Jesus' suffering, dying, and death. We don't stop there. because we wouldn't have Holy Week if we stopped on Good Friday. What makes this a Holy Week is what we formally celebrate next Sunday, Easter, His risen life that is revealed within our humanity. And we formally are baptized into the risen Christ in the waters of baptism, and that is the central element of the Easter Vigil, next Saturday, as well as next Sunday when we renew our baptismal vows. We are renewing our faith in the risen Christ. We're not dwelling on His suffering, dying, and death, because it wouldn't matter. We would not be gathering together. There would not be a Eucharist without Jesus rising from the dead. And what makes Him fully human in our humanity is because He reveals divine will. The divine will of the Father for all of humanity is to be risen from the dead, from the death of sin and the death of our bodies. This is the good news, the good news of how Christ Jesus is not an extraterrestrial. He is fully human through His fully divine oneness with us. And when we come up here to receive the body and blood of Christ, we are receiving His risen body and blood. And as a result, we can live each week of our lives as a holy week. We don't have to wait until now, this week. Every week, that is, every moment of our lives can be holy through our oneness with Christ, the risen Savior. This is where our faith is put to the refining test. When we are able to look at the sufferings, the dyings, and the deaths of our human journeys, but to look at them from the perspective of the empty tomb, that's faith. That's what it means to have faith in the divine within our humanity. It is the risen life of Christ that lives within us and lives within all of humanity now. And what makes our lives holy week after week is that we can look at the sufferings, the dyings, and the deaths of life and declare, these do not define who we are. What defines who we are is the resurrection of Christ, His risen life that is alive and vibrant within each of us. That is what is known as Holy Communion. That's what we're saying amen to in the body and blood of Christ. We are saying, amen, Lord, yes, we can face anything in this life, any suffering, dying, or death, and we can face it with joy in Your risen life that lives within us. Everything takes on a different perspective. Otherwise, we become kind of depressed. And there are people who unfortunately live life as if, well, you know, life is filled with sufferings, dyings, and deaths, and that's all there is. Well, no wonder they're depressed. No wonder they get addicted to drugs or other hurtful behaviors. No wonder they hurt their neighbors. They don't care. There's nothing. They don't see any purpose. It's all about suffering, dying, and then the final chapter is death. Those are the people who are stuck on Good Friday. Their weeks aren't too holy. They're rather miserable. And that's why we have to be careful sometimes when we meditate on the stations of the cross, because that can become a real downer. Oh, Jesus, You went through such terrible, oh my God, it was so terrible. Yes, but what He was going through all the way to His last breath on the cross, He had within Him the divine will of His Father, which is filled with new life, risen life, even as He breathed His last breath on the cross. And that's how we are to live in oneness with Christ in our holy communion with Him. We are to see each moment of life as filled with the risen Christ, with the empty tomb. That changes everything in how we view suffering, dying, and death, whether it be ours or somebody else's, or the various ups and downs and challenges and disgusts of life, frustrations. We can smile at them and say, well, yeah, this is pretty messy right now, but we've got the risen life of Christ constantly in us. And that makes eternal difference. That's what helps us to verify, to be fully human, is to be filled with the divine. And to be filled with the divine in Christ, the risen Savior, is to be filled with his resurrected life, his risen life, now and every week of our lives. So that we don't have to wait for Holy Week. Every week of our lives can be very much holy in our oneness in Christ's risen life within us. So although E.T. was a fun movie, entertaining, and although there are those who still dwell on, well, just wonder if there are extraterrestrials around, from other planets or other galaxies, we can debate that much as we want. But when it comes to the Savior of the world, Jesus, he's not an extraterrestrial being. He's not from another planet. He's in the fulfillment of the divine will of the Father to become fully human in our humanity. And to clarify that to be fully human is to be filled with the divine love of the Father. And the divine love of the Father is eternal. And it is verified in the risen Christ, the empty tomb, that when we have Holy Communion and live Holy Communion with Jesus, every week of our lives can be holy. Because we are no longer defined by suffering, dying, or death. That no longer defines who we are. What defines who we are is risen life. What defines who we are is the empty tomb. That's the full divine presence, one in our humanity.
I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. For our sake, he was crucified and crucified. He suffered death and was buried. He rose again the third day. He ascended into heaven and he sitteth at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds with the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We are risen life people, called to holiness every week of our lives. We pray now that the universal love of the Father will grow in the hearts of all of humanity this week and every week into eternal life.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the church, that this commemoration of Holy Week being renewed, bring renewed vigor to the work of spreading the gospel of Jesus, the name above all names, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the world, that the power of Christ crucified may lead lands torn apart by violence to make a commitment to justice and peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those justly convicted of violent crimes, that the suffering of Christ instill a sincere desire to change their lives, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those who are weary, weighed down by the burdens of life, that they may experience the joy of Easter, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For this community of faith, that our Lenten observance will continue to bear fruit throughout the coming year. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the souls of our brothers and sisters, Ezekiel Guadalupe and Ezekiel Jr., Carlos Godinez, Virginia Moore, Marlene and Martina Reyes, Alvina Rodriguez, Rudy Quintanilla, and Juanita and Max Sanchez, who are deceased. May they be judged in mercy on the last day, and may all of us, the living and the dead, rise in glory and grace on that great day. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those celebrating birthdays, anniversaries, or other special occasions this week, may God embrace you and continue to bless you on your journey and adventures. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for the special intentions of all gathered here today and the unspoken prayers in our hearts, join with those of Our Lady of Guadalupe and the saints in light be heard. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Loving Father, you are eternally familiar with us, for we are created in your image and likeness and confirmed with risen life in your own Son. May we live each day, each week, holy in your will and rejoice in how risen life prevails in the depths of our hearts through the Spirit of your Savior Son. We ask this in all these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Oh,
Pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
For the passion and resurrection of your only begotten Son, O Lord, we rejoice at the reconciling love constantly in our hearts. May we live with joy and gratitude at the eternal oneness revealed by your divine will through your crucified and risen Son, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has given us eternal life. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Therefore, these gifts we pray by sending your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice once more, giving thanks. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Thank you.
celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Donald, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Our Lady of Guadalupe, her spouse Saint Joseph, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased us throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, Lord God, his word is true.
Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. Live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Jesus, Lamb of God.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. I'm going to try to talk something in English. I'm going to introduce Father Carlos Sosa. He's from Dominican Republic. This is the voice in the video. Father Carlos Sosa is working in St. Augustine, the diocese in St. Augustine. He is a priest from my community, religious community. He's here in St. Patrick for this Holy Week. Welcome, Father Carlos.
Thank you very much for welcoming me into your parish. As Father Carlos was saying, I'm working in San Agustin, Florida, in Our Lady of La Leche. There is a beautiful place to honor Mary too. It's the first Marian shrine in the United States, founded by the Spanish people when they came at the beginning in 1565. Then you're more than welcome to come to make your pilgrimage to that shrine. And Father Carlos asked me to renew the invitation for April 28th. It will be a beautiful experience, because from the synod, our bishop, the church, the Holy Spirit, is inviting us not only to live our faith in the community, that is, we all together, the parish, but to have a closer experience of faith, where we may be receiving formation, growing in fraternity, growing in the service that we may offer as a church in here, and don't forget that sharing your faith in fraternity and sharing your faith with others will always help you to increase it and to have more, a deeper identity with your faith. Then April 28th, it will be after 12:30 Mass here. We will gather together with Father Carlos. I will be praying for you, but please feel the invitation from the Holy Spirit. It will renew your faith, and it will be an encouragement for this church, for this parish, to be renewed too in each of you. God bless you. I will be praying for you, and please give me your prayers.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly rejoice, O Lord, that through the death and resurrection of your Son, we have hope every day, every week of our lives, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. O Lord, in this gathering of the body of Christ, the risen Christ in our midst, may we all be instilled with a deeper faith in how your love is divinely alive and vibrant within our humanity. For he lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorify the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Amen.